This is a Choppin' It Up show brought to you by the Marching Podcast. And now here is your host, the Phantom Podcaster himself, Joe Beard.
Welcome to the Choppin' It Up show. I'm your host, Joe Beard, and happy to be of service to you. Happy and honored and grateful to be creating and producing this podcast from our Marching Podcast studio. This is the episode for the first part of July 2016. At the end of the broadcast, if you decide you like the show, then we appreciate a donation to the network, if you feel so in your heart, of course. Just simply go to themarchingpodcast.com and click on the donate button to help improve the show and help build our scholarship fund. This podcast is brought to you by Double Time Entertainment, The Edge One Productions, and Block Band Music and Publishing. If this is your first time listening, check out the website, themarchingpodcast.com. Follow our blog, blog4.themarchingpodcast.com. And follow us on Twitter, at Marching Podcast. We're on YouTube, and you can Google us, and you could find us pretty much anywhere. Thanks again for listening. This is our second broadcast from our new studio. We had some good feedback from our first episode, and we appreciate that. And we look to continue to move forward with our podcast. You can always listen to our past episodes by going to our website and clicking on the listen and follow button. On that page, you'll see a link to our YouTube page, our blog, and our past episodes on Blog Talk Radio and our feed on iTunes. Make sure to get caught up with the Marching Podcast Network. Happy 4th of July to everyone out there for this first part of the month. If you are celebrating with your family or at least with someone, it's been super hot out here in Southern California, so the fam and I are taking it easy inside the house. But we hope that you all are enjoying this first part of July for 2016. So in this podcast, we chop it up with Marvin Price. Marvin is a student at Southern University. And similar to Garrett Edgerson, shout out to the Edge One Productions, he has started a media business there on campus, showing the world the HBCU life and the campus life at Southern University. Always like to highlight the young people who are doing big things at a young age, identifying true leaders for our neighborhoods and following them as they progress through adulthood. So we're really excited about talking to Marvin, and we hope that you enjoy our conversation. In our first segment of the interview, we find out where Marvin is from, and we get some good information about his parents, and we find out how he got into the excitement for band. Lastly, in this segment, we find out where Marvin went to high school and what instrument he played. You can email the show at marchingpodcast@gmail.com, tweet us at marchingpodcast, or follow our blog, blog4.themarchingpodcast.com. You're now here with the Marching Podcast, and we always have great guests, but Mr. Marvin Price. What's going on today, man?
Hey, what's going on, man? It's good to be here.
Really appreciate your time today. Saw what you've been doing with all the media and all that. Really excited to talk to you. We also talked to Garrett Edgerson, his business, The Edge One Productions. He's actually a sponsor to the network. So we know that we're getting some good folk here. We talked to you, and I see that you on YouTube and everything. So we'll definitely get a chance to people to follow you and all that at the end. But let's go ahead and get right into it. Marvin, where are you from, man?
I am from New Orleans, Louisiana, born and raised.
Okay. Now, is your family and all of everyone that you know, are they all from the New Orleans area?
Well, my mom is from New Orleans. My dad, he was actually born in New Jersey. My grandfather, he was in the military, so they moved around a lot, and he ended up finding his way back to Louisiana as he got closer to high school. He went to Bonneville, played in a band, then went on to Southern. graduated from Southern, I believe, in 94. Yep, that's pretty much it. So my, both my mom and my dad went to Southern. As far as me going to Southern, it's, I'm, what, the second generation of my family to attend Southern University. So it's pretty cool.
Cool to keep that tradition going. So you said that your pops marched in the band?
Well, he played in the band in high school. He went to Bonneville, corps-style band. Bandhead like myself. He was in a band for a few years, then went on to win a few state championships in wrestling.
Okay.
As far as band goes, now my mom, from New Orleans, born and raised, she went to Xavier Prep High School in New Orleans, all-girl high school, and she played in the band all 4 years. She played the snare drum, and she was one of my big influences in high school when it came to joining the band. She took Mardi Gras really seriously, so I think my bandhead interest comes from her.
I was in New Orleans around that time when I was at Jackson State, and I saw that. I didn't know that it was a series of parades. I didn't know that's what Mardi Gras was. All those bands, all different levels. So it started to give me more of like an understanding about folks from New Orleans, because you guys, right. So since you actually born in the HBCU culture, my next question I usually ask folks is, what do you first remember about band?
As far as my personal experiences, I first became interested in band. Seriously, I want to say when I was in the sixth grade, had to be 2003, 2004, 11, 12 years old. I joined the band at my middle school, Marion Central, and experienced the long parade route for Mardi Gras my very first time. And I remember we did a day parade. That night, we went to go to, I believe it was Endymion. And I really paid attention to St. Aug for the very first time, St. Augustine High School Marching 100.
Mm-hmm.
They stopped in the middle of the parade, and they played Dangerously in Love. From that day forward, I was hooked. Once I did march for St. Aug for 4 years, was section lead in high school my senior year. As far as really paying attention to HBCU bands,
mm-hmm.
It was really my junior and senior years, because that's what everybody listened to, Southern playing Headbusters.
Right.
I'll never forget my senior year, 2010, 2011, my senior year in high school, everybody was talking about October 16th, 2010. That was the day of the Southern University versus Jackson State University football game. And everybody was talking about the band. And I even got excited, because that was the year that Southern and Jackson State participated in the Battle of the Bands. And as Southern was on the field getting ready to do their field show, Jackson State had cranked up Power in the stands.
Oh, okay.
And that's what everybody was talking about. And I'm like, okay. Until this day, I'd say that is the most intense Euro quarter I've ever witnessed in person. October 16th, Boombox Classic 2010, the atmosphere was just amazing. And from that day forward, that was my decision day as to where I was like, okay, even if I don't march in a band in college, I want to attend an HBCU, because there's nothing like it. There's nothing like the atmosphere, the people, the experience. And so I've been involved with HBCU culture ever since.
My crab year in 97, we marched into Memorial Stadium in Jackson, and Southern got there early. We usually come into Jackson playing, get ready. They waited till we got in front of them, right on the little piccolo solo part of get ready. Southern crunk up hay in the middle of the barn when we were marching in, and I remember, I don't know if that was the first time ever that was done, but we were all in literal surprise. Like, we were like, what's going on? Like, why are they playing? Like, but it definitely made that rivalry intense between those schools, because I know in the boom, people are still talking about it. I guess that was like 97, so that's like 13 years later. I remember how intense it was marching in the stands after that. And it really made a good classic for a lot of us. St. Aug, is that a public school?
Oh, no, that's a private school. It's an all-boy high school in New Orleans, an all-boy Catholic school.
What'd you play?
I played the tuba.
From photo shoots to graduation pictures, from pro base to band footage, from pageants to yard shows, there's only one team you can count on, the Edgemont Productions. Visit theedgemont.com and trust me, you won't be disappointed.
Hello, my name is Kellen J. Christian. I am the director of bands at Oak Haven High School in Memphis, Tennessee. I'm also the assistant director of Talladega College in Talladega, Alabama. I'm a native of Chicago, Illinois. I'm a 2007 graduate of the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff. M4, baby. Swag, stand up. And you are listening to the Marching Podcast Radio Network.
All right, we're back. Thanks again for listening, and shout out to our beloved sponsors that allow us to do special things. One thing that I remember from him telling that story is I think I was telling him my crab year about when we marched in and Southern was there and they played Hay in the Middle of the Barn on us. That's something that I'll remember, but I love to have these stories 20 years later and how the history repeats itself. He's like, oh, that was my experience. Southern played on Jackson State played Power on Southern, blah, blah, blah. Well, you got to go back just like on those 30 for 30s, on those documentaries. You got to go back to 97 to see where a lot of that rooted in. So I'm sure that maybe some people remembered that or that was on their minds when they did that. But I love the chronicles of the craft and how we can talk about what happened year to year between schools. Those are lifetime experiences that bond us, and those experiences from high school and middle school kids, it makes them march in college. It makes them go to college. And on the other side, when you're in college or you're a college student, you can tell how you felt on the field. So in our second segment, Marvin schools me more about his high school. I was surprised to hear that St. Aug was an all-boys Catholic school. He schools me more about St. Aug. He gives me his most memorable experience marching in high school. We then talk about him going to college. We already gave it away that he went to Southern, but we find out what he decides to major in and the influences on him that help him make that decision. You can email the show at marchingpodcast@gmail.com, tweet us at marchingpodcast, or follow our blog the number 4.themarchingpodcast.com.
After Hurricane Katrina, St. Mary's Academy, which is known for being an all-girls school, they allowed boys to attend their school just to accommodate for the lack of schools that was in New Orleans after the hurricane. I went to St. Mary's Academy. That was when I actually picked up a tuba for the first time. Being at St. Mary's is St. Aug's sister school, St. Augustine, they saw me and they recruited me to play in their band once I entered high school. I think St. Aug, the Marching 100, they have a very strong history. They have a very strong background when it comes to integrating Mardi Gras, being the first black band to march in a parade, the first black band to march in Rex, which is why they're always the first high school band to march in parades in New Orleans. Being that I've known that history since I was a little boy, and the fact that they were going out of their way to recruit me to play in their band, it was just a no-brainer. I was going to St. Aug, and I was going to march in their band. Some of the best 4 years of my life marching for St. Aug. I remember doing some Saints halftime shows, meeting Al Green, Archie Manning, and performing on stage with Maze and Frankie Beverly, being in Rouse's commercials. It was an experience like none other, man. There's nothing like being in a marching band.
Yeah, that's true. And I'm glad that you told me about St. Aug, because I've always heard about him, but I didn't know, assume it was a big public school. It's interesting how Southern, for all those years, was all boys. So I'm sure it was a lot of guys from St. Aug going right in there to Southern to play with all those experiences. So my next question I was going to ask you, what do you feel was your most memorable experience? And Before you answer that, I got to ask, so St. Aug, is that considered to be the high school band in the state of Louisiana?
Yes.
Okay.
Without a doubt, that is the face of Mardi Gras. You know, usually, especially the past few years, there's been a lot of college marching bands and marching parades. But immediately after the college marching bands pass, St. Aug will always be the first high school marching band in a parade that you'll see.
Wow.
Because they have earned that right and they've earned that respect.
Wow. Okay. Okay. So what out of all of the things, I guess, would you say was most memorable or something that jumps out at you out of all your experiences there at marching in St. Aug?
Well, the thing that tripped me out the most is when I really started marching, you know, for St. Aug freshman year, the very first football game. I was tripped out that we actually had a police escort to the games. It just, you know, blew my mind. I mean, we were running through red lights, stopping cars. I'm like, man, I feel like the president.
Yeah.
So I think that was just memorable, man. And, you know, it was almost like a sense of entitlement. Because there were times when we didn't have police escorts, I'm like, oh, I'm not used to, you know, stopping at a red light.
Right.
How are we going to get here on time?
That's funny you say that, because growing up, I remember seeing Jackson State or the major classics, the police escort feel excited. So I was like, man, I know I got to go march in one of those bands so I can be the police escort. You know what I'm saying? So it's funny you say that.
Right.
But that is real. The best part was experiencing it and then being on the bus and then seeing the blue and white pom-poms up and down the street or on the highway or just like when I was a kid. They're like, oh, Joseph, there go the band. Somebody saying that to their kids. I'm sure you understand the blue and white pom-poms. Now, y'all ain't tripping about that. So when did you graduate St. Aug?
I graduated from St. Aug in fall of 2011.
Okay. And then you decided to go to Southern. Did you know what your major was going to be? Did you know what you wanted to do when you got out?
Yes, I've always had an interest in filming. So right then and there, from high school, my advisors advised me that mass communication would be the field that I love. It would be the field that I love, and it would definitely be the field that I needed to get into. And I stuck with it. And it's a decision that I don't regret, honestly, because that's actually why I started filming marching bands, because it falls in line with what I do with my major.
And there's so many of you guys, so many band media there in Louisiana, New Orleans.
Right.
Gerard Howard to Jackson State with me. He's a couple of years ahead of me.
I think in 95, I think he said he crabbed.
Yeah, 95. Yeah. I was crab 96, but I was at Johnson C. Okay. Smith my first year. And then I transferred to Jackson State, so I was crab there 97. But yeah, I remember seeing Gerard around, and he was always filming, always had that camera. And of course, he's one of the people that helped start the guest book. So that's pretty cool. So again, this is now so much of the culture. You started filming. Did you want to film? You fell in love with filming more than actually marching. Is that why you decided not to march at Southern?
Yes, absolutely, because I was getting the best of both worlds. I was actually training myself up to do what I want to do once I get into the real world after college while staying around something that I love. It's very rare that people can do both, really enjoy doing it. So it took me a while to really get things going, man. When I first started filming, I didn't have money, talking about it when it comes to buying media equipment. I couldn't afford a camera. I was a broke college freshman.
Right.
So I made do with what I had, and over time, I started saving up money, and then the camera started getting better, the quality started getting better, and then more people started paying attention. And I'm blessed to be where I am today. Trust me, I do not take anything for granted. You mentioned Gerard Howard earlier. If you go ask him, he'll tell you that every time I see him, I'm always picking his brain about something.
Yeah.
Because he's certainly a mentor in my eyes. In my eyes, he's probably the best videographer out there when it comes to, well, he's the first. So he started all of this. I think he said he started filming in 1997, filming marching bands. Before that, it was just pictures. I can learn a lot from him. I've learned a lot from him. I'm still learning a lot from him. watching guys like Gerard Howard and James McDaniels and Tate Master himself, Ryan Hicks, the originators of all of this, can really learn from a lot and just make the HBCU band culture better.
Double Time Entertainment. Our passion is music and promoting HBCU marching bands as well as high school marching bands through high-quality movie videos and photos. We have worked with BET, Yamaha, Ludwig, Honda Motor Company, and been featured on CNN and Lifetime Network's series, Bama State Style. We also help and orchestrate Battle of the Bands with marketing and promotions, and also became the official media team for the Queen City Battle of the Bands in Charlotte, North Carolina. Join Double Time Entertainment on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube, and now new on Periscope. Music lovers are noteworthy.
Hello, this is Jerron Flynn, lead educational specialist for KIPP LA Charter Schools, proud husband and father, and graduate of the great Morehouse College. And you are listening to the Marching Podcast Radio Network.
All right, we're back. Thanks again for listening, and thanks again to our beloved sponsors. What I remember most about the second segment was the police escorts. The same point from the first segment, and when I talked about memories, I can still see the police escort for the boom coming down the highway when we were in Memphis or when we were in Indianapolis, and the cars honking and the blue and white pom-poms up and down the highway. That will sit with me forever. And then when I was in the boom, I remember being on the bus and then seeing the cars honking and the pom-poms. Those things will sit with you, and it's really, really special to share these memories. So I really was excited to hear him say about police escorts. That brought back a lot of memories for me. In our third segment, we get a look into being a videographer. Now, videographers are the guys that film all of this stuff that we're talking about for the craft, and they post these videos on YouTube mostly or their individual website, and they post the battles or the competitions and or halftime shows of the games from middle school, high school, and college. You can follow us on our blog, the4.themarchingpodcast.com, and on the right you'll see suggested links. These are all these suggested links and all the individual websites and YouTube channels of the people that are producing the craft and putting the videos of show-style marching bands on the web. If you follow us on Twitter, we do a lot of retweets, and we like a lot of the videos, and that will be tweeted out under our account for you guys to see. So you guys make sure you check out what being a videographer is, because these guys are essentially promoting the craft all over the world, and it's helping me out here essentially create this show and also show young people how fun it is, or just an example of a great competition. This is something that's very, very important. So we get an inside look and an inside take from Marvin about being a videographer. He gives us his YouTube channel. And lastly, he tells us why he picked the name for his channel and what you can expect to see when you tune in. You can email the show at marchingpodcast@gmail.com, tweet us at marchingpodcast, or follow our blog, blog4.themarchingpodcast.com.
You have your own YouTube channel, right?
And it's funny that you say that, because I try to get feedback from a lot of my subscribers, man. It's amazing. I remember getting excited when I had first got 100 subscribers. Now I'm at 11,000 subscribers, and it's like,
wow,
it's amazing. So, and, you know, I always said no matter how big I get, I always want to be accessible.
Mm-hmm.
So I always get feedback on how I can get better from different band media people, and from different band members themselves on what I can do and what I can improve and what they like to see. And the good thing about all of these different videographers and media teams is that everybody has their own different style.
Mm-hmm.
All of the major film crews, they have their own different styles. You know what Marvin Price is going to bring to the table You know what Gerard Howard is going to bring to the table. You know what Killer Cav, Kevin Allen himself, you know what he's going to bring.
Mm-hmm.
You know what to expect from everybody who's filming. And sometimes you just like to see a different perspective or a different view of what your band looks and sounds like. So it's a lot of us, but there's room for everybody that's in there right now.
Right.
And that's the beauty of it. It's the same event on different channels, different TV stations, and it looks different on every single one, but it looks good. I was just going to say that that's the beauty of it. That's the beauty of media. That's the beauty of photography and filming and developing your own craft and your own style. It's to find a way to be different from everybody else without sacrificing the quality of what band heads want to see.
There's a group on Facebook, the HBCU Videographers.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're on that group. I'm thinking, and I've told this to some of the listeners, other the videographers we've talked to, what's really cool is that you guys are supportive of one another. And then you
right.
post things on that page. And James and you, I've seen a lot of people saying like supportive things. Make sure you got your tapes ready, guys, or make sure you post the stuff up before Sunday. Or it's like a big union. That's what it's like. I really
You know what? It's needed because a lot of people don't understand what we go through. It's amazing, especially home games for me. The game can end at 9 and clips can start posting. You can see clips posted by 9:30. That's how quick we are. And sometimes people take for granted what we do, how much money we put into our craft, how much money we put into traveling, car rentals, stuff like that. And it's good to be around people who understand the sacrifices that we go through as far as getting media credentials, as far as applying, dealing with band directors who don't want you to film in front of their bands because you from a different university. There's just so many things that come into play. And people, the general population, they don't really understand that.
Mm-hmm.
So it's good to be in a group to where, okay, everybody's going through what I'm going through.
Yeah.
Everybody knows the struggle. And everybody has the same passion that I have. And so it's good to have that connection.
I really enjoy what you guys do. It helps us. So like you said, you're in mass communications, decided to build your channel, taping bands. What do you aspire?
Well, I call it Dr. Price TV, and I started calling. I have a name around campus as Dr. Price.
Okay.
And people are like, okay, why do you call yourself Dr. Price? I call myself Dr. Price because it's a reminder every day, okay, there's bigger aspirations that you have to reach for. Instead of settling just for a bachelor's degree, go for your master's, go for your PhD. So I believe I got a strong faith. I believe that some things you have to speak things into existence. If you see yourself being a nurse, call yourself nurse. If you see yourself getting a PhD in the future, call yourself doctor. Keep calling me Dr. Price. One day I'm going to have a PhD and you won't have a choice but to call me Dr. Price. And it was also a catchy name. My last name is Price. So television, it's the reason why I decided to call it television instead of media or productions is because there's more than just a band on my YouTube channel. There's coverage of Greek life. There's coverage of the college culture. Put all of that together, you get Dr. Price Television.
Fan directors, have you ever found yourselves in this situation? Showtime is quickly approaching. Your budget is quickly disappearing. Your music choices are narrowing. The equipment condition is wearing and your stress level is mounting. Stop what you're doing and contact Block Band Music and find out how we've got you. Check www.blockbandmusic.com. Providing music, equipment, gear, and accessories to show style, core style, and traditional bands worldwide.
What's up, band heads? This is Christy Walker, alum of the Blue and Gold Marching Machine of North Carolina A&T State University and one of the creators of thefifthquarter.com. And you are chopping it up on the Marching Podcast Network.
All right, we're back, and thanks again to our beloved sponsors. One thing that I remember from the third segment, Marvin talking about being a videographer, there's a style that's involved. Just like there's a way to shoot football, just like there's a way to shoot basketball, where the camera is before the snap, where the camera is when they're bringing the ball up, there's a way to shoot golf. Well, believe it or not, there's a way to shoot bands. Where the camera is when the band is coming on the field, during the halftime show, marching in the stands, the fifth quarter. There are a lot of things that people don't know that come into account as far as just shooting the actual performance. They take things to the next level even now with the branding and the special effects. And now I'm even noticing different camera angles and different points of views. They're really taking it to the next level. So these guys should really be commended. I love them for what they do. And again, it's what helps start this network for scholarships. So again, there's some young people out there seeing these videos and they're like, hey, man, I can do that. Man, I'm getting into that. So in our fourth and final segment, we talk about what happened this fall to Dr. Price TV and what essentially kind of put them out there or put them in another place. And lastly, Marvin wraps it up by giving us all of his information so that we can start to follow him and support him. You can email the show at marchingpodcast@gmail.com, tweet us at marchingpodcast, or follow our blog, blog4.themarchingpodcast.com.
So we're getting towards the end of the interview. What would you say has been your most memorable experience there at Southern University?
The Last Bayou Classic, the Battle of the Band. I'll never forget. I was nervous as hell before the Battle of the Band started because I just wanted to make sure that I covered the event well. I just wanted to make sure my team member that was working with me was on the right page. And I was just a nervous wreck. I just wanted everything to go well. Southern played America the Beautiful, then they played Dells. I didn't think that song was going to be as big as it turned out to be. And I wasn't in no rush to hurry up and get it put on YouTube. I didn't want to pay for parking, so I had my mom come and pick me up after the Battle of the Bands. And thank God I was there. She started having car trouble.
Wow.
So we had to get that. Yeah, we had to get that situated. Got home, I posted the video. I woke up to 5,000 views on that video alone, the game. By the time I got back from the game, it was at 15,000. I'm like, okay, this is interesting. Then the day after, it was at 32,000. I'm like, okay. Then it started blowing up. Then I see a USA Today article, and then I see all of these major media outlets posting the video. And I'm like, oh, my goodness, what in the world is going on? And lo and behold, 1 million views later, it was something that I'll never forget for the rest of my life. Not too many people can say that MTV.com and Billboard.com posted their video on their site. And that's just a blessing, man, because I do this for my university just as much as I do it to help me out in the long run as well. And anytime you can give your university international exposure, it's just something that you could cherish for the rest of your life. And hopefully Human Jukebox and the Southern University school itself really benefits from it down the line. So that's probably my most memorable moment.
I was wondering if you were going to bring that up because I definitely wanted you to, because that was probably one of the biggest things for us, just having that huge exposure. And it's not hazing or us stealing from one another or something crazy going on at our school. So it was really cool to see that on that national level, because people, man, folks go crazy over Adele. Well, they were back then. It's kind of died down some. And it was, timing was really, really good. Your band director really should be commending on that.
Yeah.
Time was really
Mr.
good
Hamer,
for that song.
Mr. Hamer, the greatest arranger to ever do it. He's just that great at what he does.
So we're getting to the end of the interview. And again, like I said, I really appreciate your time. How can we follow you? Can you give us all of your information so that we can check out everything that you do?
You can subscribe to my YouTube channel at youtube.com/Marvin Price. Subscribe or follow us on Instagram at Dr. Price TV, Facebook Marvin Price, My personal Instagram account is DrPrice_isRight.
Okay. And you not on Twitter?
Oh, I am on Twitter as well. You can follow me on Twitter at DrPrice_isRight. I do follow back.
And so when do you finish up? And do you have any immediate plans right after school?
Yes, I do graduate this upcoming December 2016, Dr. Price Studios in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, coming soon.
All right. Well, that's outstanding, man. Like I say, we're proud of what you're doing, and we'll keep supporting you. Again, thanks a lot for your time, man.
Thank you for having me.
Hello, my name is Kellen J. Christian. I am the director of band at Oak Haven High School in Memphis, Tennessee. I'm also the assistant director of Talladega College in Talladega, Alabama. I'm a native of Chicago, Illinois. I'm a 2007 graduate of the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff. M4, baby. Swag, stand up. And you are listening to the Marching Podcast Radio Network.
Hello, this is Jerron Flynn, lead educational specialist for KIPP LA Charter Schools, proud husband and father, and graduate of the great Morehouse College. And you are listening to the Marching Podcast Radio Network.
What's up, band heads? This is Christy Walker, alum of the Blue and Gold Marching Machine of North Carolina A&T State University and one of the creators of thefifthquarter.com. And you are chopping it up on the Marching Podcast Network.
All right, we're back. We want to, again, thank Marvin for his time for a wonderful interview. Shout out to Marvin Price. Dr. Price and Dr. Price TV, shout out to you, and shout out to all the young people out there doing their thing, and good luck with graduation here coming up this fall. If you're interested in becoming a sponsor or a patron to the Marching Podcast, please contact the show and we'll give you the criteria so we can help to pub your business. We'll play your commercial, we'll post your website on our blog, and we'll help send out your information through social media. So contact us so we can help build your business. What I remember from the last part of the interview with Marvin is much when he talked about Adele. So essentially what happened was at the Bayou Classic, at the Battle of the Bands, Southern played the Adele song called Hello. Very popular song. Adele was like massive popular back this past fall. But you have to give the credit to the band directors. The timing was perfect in playing this song. So like Marvin said, he would pretty much leave and go back and check in. He has so many followers. And then next thing you know, MTV and a lot of the major media outlets got a hold of the tape. So it was good for Southern. It's good for all HBCU bands, really. And again, like Marvin said, we hope that we can build on that so that Southern can benefit and all of us in the craft can benefit as well. That's all the time we have for the show. Check out our website and donate what's in your heart to themarchingpodcast.com. Like us on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter. Thanks to you for listening. And remember, the eye is a better pupil and more willing than the ear. Advice may be misleading, but examples are always clear. See you next time.